serpent spirit is coming. While I was fasting and praying in Jerusalem on the 14th of June 2023, it happened during this year after we had finished conducting our annual conference in Israel. I always go a few days before and then I stay back a few days or a week after to just fast and pray, you know. So on the 14th of June 2023, at 10 in the morning, I had a visitation from the Saint Moses. And the prophet and the Saint Elijah came together with him. And they two were present. And the Saint Moses looked at me and he said, "A serpent spirit is going to come. This serpent, which is deception, is going to come all over the world and it's going to begin in Jerusalem. A serpent spirit is going to come. Serpent, which is deception, is going to come all over the world. No more in just one nation here, another nation there. No more. This will be a global problem." You know, I tell you one secret. When COVID-19 pandemic happened, it somehow opened a door in the spiritual realm. From then onwards, anything that happens is on a global scale. No more a regional scale. It just opened a door in the heavens, in the spiritual realm, for good and for bad. For the bad, for the works of the devil, they are all be on a global scale. For good, the works of God will also be on a global scale. No more one nation here, one church here, or one church there. No, what God will do will be on a global scale. All the churches experiencing it at the same time. And the works of the devil that take place will also be on a global scale, all over the nations, all against the people of God at the same time. What you will experience here, someone else on the other part of the earth will also be experiencing it at the same time. What happens in your church will also be simultaneously happening somewhere else in the world at the same time, because it will be a global problem from now onwards. So a serpent spirit is going to come, which is deception. It's going to come all over the world. And as the Saint Moses spoke with me, I saw a large, heavy, black cobra coiled around in one corner. It was coiled around and then it lifted up its head and it was hissing. Hissing. So what is going to happen? 1 Timothy chapter 4 verse 1 says, "Now the Spirit expressly says that in the latter times some will depart from the faith, giving heed to deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons." So this serpent spirit is not just one spirit. It is the main one, but below him there are his cohorts. Millions of them. And they all carry the same anointing. And what is it? To deceive. That is what this serpent stands for. To deceive. And that's what the scripture says. Deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons. Now will go out all over the world. And what is their purpose? To deceive the people of God. That's the purpose. Now when will this happen? The scripture says very clearly, in the last days. Latter times. Latter times means the last days, which means our time. In these times that we are living in. The Lord Jesus Christ, in the last sermon that he preached before he was crucified, mentioned that deception will be a sign of the last days. In Matthew chapter 24 verse 5, And Mark chapter 13 verse 22. And Jesus answered and said to them, take heed that no one deceives you. That's his first sentence. When the apostle Peter asked him, Lord, what will be the sign of your coming? The first sentence the Lord Jesus said is, be careful that no one deceives you. That's the first sentence, which means deception will be rampant in unmeasurable manner in the last days. So much so, even the elect will be deceived. Elect are those who walk very close with God. If they can be deceived, how much more the common people? There's no hope for the common people if the elect can be deceived. When Lucifer fell, we know from scriptures that a group of angels, not one third, that's wrong teaching. Popular wrong teaching of one third. I don't have the time to prove to you that, but you believe what I say, right? It is wrong. Anyway, many angels, millions of angels fall. Now, those angels who fall are not ordinary angels. They are of very high rank, similar to this title called the elect. So they all fell together with him. Big, big, huge demons. Big, big angels who once upon a time served God, bowed down to worship God. They were deceived. Deceived by this great serpent. Now the word deceive in the Greek is called planao. P-L-A-N-A-O. And the word planao means to lead astray, to cause to wander, to go astray, to mislead, to deceive, to seduce, delude. Simply put, the word planao means to roam away from the truth. Or to put it more simply, it means to go astray. Causing someone to go astray. That's what the word deceive means. If I'm a deceiver, I will teach you teachings, wrong teachings that will cause you to go astray from the true doctrines of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what a deceiver is. And that's what deception is going to do in these last days. The serpent has been present since creation in the Garden of Eden. Among all the animals that God created, he also created the serpent. The serpent was not created by the devil. Right, everybody? The serpent was created by God. Genesis chapter 3 verse 1 says, the serpent was among the creation of all the cattle and all the wild beasts in the garden. So it was part of the creation of God. However, why was the serpent chosen? As I read the scripture very carefully this afternoon, I found something why the devil chose the serpent among all other animals. He could have chosen a peacock. He could have chosen a monkey that never stays in one place. Or a donkey or a horse, more beautiful than a serpent, right? He could have chosen any. Why particularly the serpent? Genesis 3:1 says, and now the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field. Now the word cunning, by the way, today we have a bad understanding of the word cunning. But this is what exactly it means, cunning. Cunning in the Hebrew means arum. A-R-U-M. And the word arum means wise and understanding. prudent, clever. This is what the word cunning means. Positively. In the negative sense, it means crafty. Crafty. Very cunning. Cunning, crafty. One who devises evil. So this serpent was a very wise and understanding, prudent and clever beast among all other beasts. And that is why the devil chose that. If you look at history, every false prophet, every false teacher, or every false religious leader who have ever come to this world so far are not ordinary believers. Right? They are some high-ranking teachers, wise people, clever people, who has charisma, who has leadership abilities. The devil used them. Because then the masses can be lured away. Use their cunning wisdom, their mind, to deceive. Once, when they are deceived, they will deceive you in return. First, it is a self-deception comes first. Then, the one who self-deceive will deceive another. Like produces like. So that's why the devil was chosen. Serpent was chosen. And the word Arum comes from the word Aram. Aram. A-R-A-M. And it means smoothness. Smooth talking with a cunning intention. Deceivers don't preach like me, loud and robust. They come with sweet words. God loves you. No matter how much you sin, God loves you. Right? They talk sweet words, sugar-coated words, so that you will fall sway to all their sweet words. They would not speak like Elijah. He looked at Ahab and he said, "You will go to hell. You're doomed. I'm not the troublemaker of Israel. You are the troublemaker of Israel." Which one of you dare to go to the White House and look at President Biden and say, "You are a troublemaker"? Will you? We will send Dr. White as our representative. See, how many will die today? But that is the caliber of a true prophet of God. They don't care for fame, name, popularity, money, whether you give them offering or they don't give them offering. That's okay. Widows take care of prophets, you know. Those who have nothing will take care of a prophet. But those deceivers are not like that. They speak smooth words. Smooth, pleasing words, pleasant to the eyes, pleasant to the ears, to deceive. So the first nature of a serpent is it is subtle. Very subtle. The way of the devil, subtle. Second nature, it incites. I-N-C-I-T-E-S. Incites. Genesis chapter 3 verse 1 is written very beautifully in the book of Jasher chapter 1 verses 9 to 10. Now the extra biblical book of Jasher is also mentioned in the book of Joshua. So for some reason we do not know why it was not included in the canon of the Bible, but it is a valid true book. So let me now read to you how Genesis 3:1 is written in the book of Jasher chapter 1 verses 9 to 10. "And the serpent which God had created with them in the earth came to them to incite." them to transgress the commandment of God which he had commanded them. So the second nature of the serpent is it incites. Now what does the word incite means? Urges. It urges, come on, go on. Sin, go on. It gently pushes you. It just pushes you, urges you. Go ahead, take the fruit, eat, go ahead. Eve was lingering, you know, below the tree, and he just urged her, come on, you can do it. Come on, you can do it. Just like a coach would encourage you. Instead of encouraging, he's urging you, do it, do it, do it. So thirdly, the devil or the serpent incites. Secondly, and thirdly, it entices. Entices or persuades. And the serpent, Genesis chapter 3 verse 10. And the serpent enticed. And now I'm still reading from the book of Jasher, chapter 1 verse 10. And the serpent enticed and persuaded the woman to eat from the tree of knowledge, and the woman hearkened to the voice of the serpent, and she transgressed the word of God, and took from the tree of knowledge of good and evil, and she ate, and she took from it, and gave also to her husband. Now look at the first sentence. The serpent enticed and persuaded. The word entice means to arouse a desire. When you are enticed, your desires are aroused. For good or for bad. If it is a lustful desire, you will end up committing a lustful act. Like how King David did in 2 Samuel chapter 11. But the same arousal can arouse to seek after God. To seek his love, to seek his presence. So it can either be good or bad. And the word persuade means to move a person by argument. So if you put these two words together, it tells us the serpent, inspired by the devil, enticed and persuaded Eve to eat the fruit from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. It persuaded her, even though she was lingering. Should I or should I not? Should I or should I not? But it persuaded her forcefully. Persuaded. You'll find this word persuaded used by the Apostle Paul in the book of Romans, where he said, Apostle Paul is a very strong-headed Pharisee. Very righteous Pharisee by the strict rule of the law. Never ate any unclean food. But he says, all foods are clean. And he said, the Lord persuaded me 3 times. The Lord had to persuade him because of his heart hate. Persuaded him, all are clean. All are clean. So persuaded means strong argument. You move a person by strong argument. The fourth characteristics of a serpent causes to doubt. A good example is found in the life of the Lord Jesus. In Matthew chapter 4 verse 3. Now when the tempter came to him, he said, if you are the Son of God, command that these stones become bread. Now, if you analyze this scripture, the devil did not come to the Lord Jesus, said, sir, you are so hungry for not eating any food, drinking any water for 40 days. Why don't you turn these stones to bread? I'm sure you can do that. It was not a suggestion. The suggestion was the second part. The first part was a doubt. If you are the Son of God. See, if you are the Son of God, why did he specifically say that? Because in Matthew chapter 3 verse 17, During the baptism of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Father spoke to him, "This is my beloved Son." He said that publicly. John the Baptist heard that. The Lord Jesus heard that. So did the devil. Right? "This is my beloved Son." Now the Lord Jesus Christ knew his call. That was a call, you know. The Son of God is a title given to him for the role, for the incarnation he took as a man to die for our sins. Son of God. If you read Luke chapter 3, the last verse, it says, "And Adam, the Son of God, begotten by God." So the Lord Jesus, the second Adam, took the place of the first Adam, called as the Son of God. So now, the Lord Jesus knew his call. He is the Son of God. Here comes the tempter. "Are you really sure? Are you really sure you have that calling? Are you really sure? Did God call you for that work? Are you really sure?" See, he stirs you. When you get a call, someone else from your church or your colleague or your friends will come and say, "Are you really sure? Do you have a confirmation? Second confirmation, third confirmation, fourth confirmation, 5, 6, 7, 8. Why do you need to have confirmations if you have a good relationship with the Lord Jesus? The serpent, what is unique about the serpent? It is a beguiling deception. 2 Corinthians chapter 11 verse 3, the first part says, "But I fear lest somehow as the serpent deceived Eve by his craftiness." Now look at these two important words. Deceived. Secondly, craftiness. Now the word craftiness in the Greek means cunning. Cunning means twisting God's words. Twisting. Inside, outside, put the grammar and the nouns and the verbs the other way around so that the entire sentence sounds different. It's same, but it sounds different. And the devil is a master of that. Similar to how he deceived Eve. In Genesis chapter 3 verse 4 and 5 we read, "Then the serpent said to the woman, 'You will not surely die. For God knows that in the day you eat of it, your eyes will be open and you will be like God, knowing good and evil.'" "You will not surely die" is a lie. It's a lie because God said, "You will surely die." He said, "No, you will not die. You will be like God. You'll be like God." Deception. Crafty. Crafty, twisting the word of God. And he tried the same trick on the Lord Jesus. In Matthew chapter 4, verses 5 and 6. "Then the devil took him up into the holy city and set him on the pinnacle of the temple and said to him, 'If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, He shall give his angels charge over you, and in their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone.'" That here comes the devil quoting a scripture. Now listen carefully, people of God. If you stray away from the righteous path of God, the devil will give you a confirmation based on the word of God. And you will think it is God giving you a confirmation. Because you already strayed away from the path of God. So the serpent, with his seducing spirits, will deceive and cause rebellion. Will not only deceive, but will also cause rebellion. How? I'll give you two examples. Genesis chapter 3 verse 6. Satan caused Eve to rebel against the word of God. God told her specifically, "You shall not eat of the fruit from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. He told them, but she rebelled against the word of God. Satan enticed to rebel. Secondly, Jude verse 11 says that a man called Korah, who was a relative of the prophet Moses, rebelled against Moses. You read about this in Numbers chapter 16. Korah, Dathan, Abihu, and Oholiab. Four of them, all from the tribe of Levi, who were distant relatives of the prophet Moses, rebelled against his leadership, enticed by the devil. So that's what the devil does, cause you to rebel. Whenever you feel any rebellion rising inside you, instantly recognize it's from the devil and stop it. Stop it immediately. Don't entertain those thoughts of rebellion. Don't entertain. If you have a difference with your pastor, go and talk to him. Pastor, I have this disagreement with you. Your pastor will be able to explain to you from his point of view. If you agree, stay. If you don't agree, live quietly. That's the righteous thing to do. You live quietly and don't bring a group with you. If you ever do that, that is the work of the devil. When he left heaven, he brought a company with him. See, people do that today, right? So why do they do that today? They receive that anointing from the devil. Truly they are anointed, but not from God, from the evil one.